Welcome back, everybody, to the LCS Challengers League promotion tournament, where we witnessed a crazy game one in our first promotion match between Lit Esports and CCG. CCG was ahead for a lot of that early game, Cubby, and then Lit came storming back to game one.
Yeah, I'm in the pause. I was trying to get up tweets about Rockboom's Kai'Sa, man. I didn't have time to pull it off, but I was so impressed with how Rockboom played that fight. Or I should say many of the fights in that game. That was a comp where you have to attack the Jinx and the Orianna. There were a lot of ways that Lit were able to get the Kai'Sa in, but some of the decisions that Rockboom made in that game were really, really good Kai'Sa plays. So I think that for me, Lit coming together as a team, they had some good team calls, but then it was the individual performance of Rockboom on top of that really pushed them over the top against CCG. Really fun game one.
Yeah, CCG, you know, they had the early game lead. They had the two big carries in the Orianna Jinx, and I thought that they were going to be able to run away with that game. If I saw that situation happen in Challengers, you know, or in qualifiers, I should say, 20 minutes later, I'm looking at Instinct having 20 kills, 3 pentakills, and just, you know, a very quick game win. So things are different here as the NACL reps maybe giving them a little bit of a challenge. We can take a look at the banned champions here. As remember, we are in Fearless. This is something that we're going to have to track throughout the entire series. CCG, as we said, and Lit, actually, have not played a series in Fearless that have lasted more than 3 games. And so, you know, if CCG want to come back, those champ pools really going to be a big topic of conversation.
Yeah, I love the fact, I do want to return to that point, that things are different in this tournament, because there were so many games for Lit where I saw them be down, you know, 3-4k gold at 15 the way we saw them in that game, and that was it, right? It was done and dusted, and Lit couldn't really lane well enough to get them into games, and we didn't get to see the moments of their team play. But we did see some good moments from Lit with how they were able to fight, how they were able to work as a team, especially earlier on in the split. And they did play some close series in the back half of the split that just didn't go their way. They challenged Disguised on their way to try and not be in this promotion tournament. But now that they're here, we did still see them get behind in lane. I thought the early game for CCG was very strong, but then we did get to see those good moments from Lit, how they're able to play off each other. I still think that four-man solution topside to get Jinx when she was going for the top outer after they just killed the bot turret was really the thing that changed the game for me. That was such a big call and such a big trap that CCG fell into. Like, it gave Lit the momentum they needed for the rest of that one, and they just kept on going in, right? You're playing Nautilus, Kai'Sa in the Jinx, remove the summoner spells, keep on fighting. Lit did not give up, and their hands prevailed in the end.
Now, going into game two then, Cubby, you see here, CCG can't play the Ori and the Jinx again. And Message also cannot play that Ori again. I know that's been a big pick for him. If you're CCG, do you go back to a similar team fighting scaling composition? Or, knowing that Lit have this option of, you know, going for this dive-focused threat, you go for something else instead. You look for a little bit more agency in that mid game.
I think if you're CCG, you stick to your guns. And for me, I was kind of surprised we didn't see Senna deny. One thing I will say in Fearless, so there's this big meta in LCK about Senna Nautilus. And if you let those through, you have to deny the other. Well, in this, if you first pick Nautilus and don't pick Senna, guess what? You do get a free Senna Nautilus game. So I'm really interested to see if CCG does go for something like Senna Nautilus to try and set that up in this.
Oh yeah, maybe Lit are going to be forced to ban Senna.
I think they have to ban
Senna now.
Yeah.
If that happens. So we're headed into the draft right now. The Jinx, of course, cannot be played by Instinct, as we said. Bot lane's, I think, going to be a big target in terms of how the draft ends up going, not only because of that Senna matchup that you were talking about, but also just how big of a carry Rockboom was specifically at the end of that game.
Agree, and it's funny because with the Jinx ban, I almost feel like Lit is somewhat forced to ban Varus, Senna, Kalista, or the Ashe being taken away too. Like, you have a choice now. Do I let through Senna or Kalista? Because some of Kalista's bad matchups are already off the table. Knowing Rockboom, he would be willing to play something like Tristana into it. Is this a champ that Rockboom knows? And I know that sounds kind of weird, but Tristana is an old school counter into Kalista that I think is still somewhat doable. So I expect CCG to really pick a mid laner here. Also, Bradley's pool is so deep for Fearless. Or really pick AD. I know mids are sometimes on the table, but Bradley's pool is so deep that I'd be surprised if they took mids so early.
So after banning 3 champions that CCG played in game number one, I guess they are very scared of, you know, copying their homework a little bit. So we're going to see a lot of different champions this time around. But, you know, Messages still has, you know, the Azir available to him. That was something that was re-enabled at the start of this promotion tournament. I know he played a lot of. And so perhaps some early focus on that is, I think Messages specifically, going to have his pool tested a little bit here in this best of 5.
I will say Instinct, not exactly known to be the Kalista player, more of the team fighter, instead of being lane dominant. So I do think these bans from Lit are appropriate, and they're not going to take the Kalista this game, or at least not yet. It will be that Azir for Bradley, and the insta-Talia response for messages. So this makes something like Kalista very difficult to even draft. So AD pushed really far down the totem pole. And now I know comfort for each of these players is Zeri. And I'm really looking at Zeri to be like, hey, where is this pick going to end up in draft? And I think for CCG, taking something like Zeri here, it's kind of dangerous even to Talia Wukong. That's a lot to execute, and the combo is rather sound. So I like the strong mid jungle that they have taken, and I'm curious how CCG responds.
Yeah, I was expecting an early jungle, but just wasn't sure what exactly it was going to be. I feel like Kindred and Xin Zhao are the two champions that stick out to me when I think of Fizno. But Wukong also something that can do a lot in these team fights, and so Lit have set themselves up very nicely in this 2v2. It will be matched up by Yukino Xin Zhao, and that can very much turn into a problem. You know how skilled he is on this champion specifically. One of his comfort picks even dating back to last season on 100 Thieves. And so it looks like the mid jungles very set up for themselves right now. And we'll see what the bot lane situation looks like, as I would assume like an AD carry or a support is going to be locked in here on 3.
They could just slam top too if they wanted to blind it. It would give Dragoon the chance to respond. And important to note that Darius is not available, but Nott actually just picked up. Okay. So we're just going to slam the Nautilus. No Senna Nautilus game for either team. Senna, of course, has other options, and Nautilus is a very dominant support. I mean, a lot of teams talk about how it's important to make use of your Nautilus game, because he does bring a bit of everything on the Rift, and Lit and Plux made good use of him that game. Xayah being taken means that if Azir jumps in, you have a way to play around Depth Charge. Does give some flexibility, but you got to believe a Rakan ban's coming out from CCG.
Yeah, I know that this is something that Rockboom played a lot of in his first Oki run back in spring 2023 with Rock Bottom Esports. That team made it all the way to the finals, but just was unable to qualify because they did not play in the first qualifier. So Rockboom always at the top of that tier 3 level until he ended up promoting, and it was a lot of because of this champion specifically. There's the Rakan ban you were talking about.
That was so
Aphelios
fast.
Has been a pretty good combo as well with the Nautilus, and so I would expect maybe another AD carry ban. That Zeri's still on the table.
I would think about Braum ban, as Xin and Nott just both have to jump in, and Braum, you have a lot of ways to proc Winner's Bite with Xayah and Nott. The Kai'Sa and the Aphelios being taken away, that's a lot of marksmen off the table. And I gotta say, Zeri and Xayah is not the greatest matchup in the world. Xayah, if she gets the Azul tempo going, does have the ability to try and space Zeri, and if Zeri overcommits, it can be a problem, as the Dragoon tax is paid instead. So no support ban. It will be the Darius being taken away from Dragoon. We'll be curious to see if he gets his hands on that this series. It does make a little bit more sense for me on blue side when I take that away. I thought banning it as early as they did on red side was a bit of an oops. I think there's some strategy to giving Dragoon to something like Darius early on in Fearless. You don't have to worry about it for the rest of draft. It's already been two bans that have been used on a pick like that.
And especially now it's a best of five, right? Sometimes in a best of three can get a little scary because, you know, then you're suddenly putting yourself at match point if they end up winning. But they still have counterpick for Dragoon here on R5. I will say I would like to see something like an Olaf potentially here for Crimson. It goes pretty well into some of the things that I know that Dragoon can play specifically pretty well, things like Sante and the Mordekaiser. So and also something that Crimson is very confident about blind picking in the top lane. Right now we're just going to see this area though, so sacrificing what could be a bit of a worse lane matchup for better team fighting later on.
Now there's no, or there could be a Gragas response from Dragoon if he wants it, but no Jax. Dragoon, he does like Mordekaiser a bit into Renekton. Again, removing something like Xin Zhao, not bad for Mord. As Plux is hovering Shaco.
Yeah, they were doing it in game one too. I can't seem to remember why. I
appreciate Lit hovering Shaco. I find that very funny up here on the caster desk. That being said, yeah, I think it will be the Mordekaiser for Dragoon. So this is something usually I see him go Bramble Vest Rush. He didn't do it against Denethor, and he got solo killed, so I'm wondering if he returns to that. I think you do need that against the Renekton. It was definitely big in the Gore Drinker days, but it is something where Dragoon, this is definitely a comfort pick for him, and being able to remove something like Xin Zhao in the front line, where Mordekaiser, you just get bonus stats, you pretty much eat him alive in Death Realm, is something that's rather valuable for Lit. It could make some more space for Xayah.
Yeah, I mean, we talk about Dragoon Darius a lot, but this Mordekaiser also kind of in that pocket pick can bring it out and really knows all the matchups super well against any top laner that he ends up playing against. And so Dragoon going to be in good spirits this time around as he takes his opponents to the Spirit Realm. And Lit have a very interesting composition set up for themselves. It's not exactly 5v5 with that Mordekaiser getting thrown in there.
Yeah, it's something where I think that Lit, they have good combos off of Taliyah, and I really want to see them try and play and commit to that. And then for CCG, this is the win lane, win game team again. Xin Zhao with three lanes that I feel like have push. Want to see if CCG can get that lead like they had in game one, but this time maintain it.
Yeah, we're onto the Rift now. Game number two, Lit have the opportunity to send themselves to match point and just send themselves to one game away from promoting back in to the NACL. CCG, of course, their expectation was to promote, and so being down in a series is not where they are, you know, traditionally expecting themselves to be. But remember, they were also down 1-0 in their first series against Ole Miss, and they were able to come back pretty handily. So the big question is how they're able to bounce back here.
And for Lit, I mean, I feel like this is a team that really embraces being an underdog. I'm even going to go for a bit of a reach here and be like, that's kind of the situation that Rockboom's been in with St. Clair, too. It's actually a pretty solid collegiate team that just missed top four last year. I got to pause.
Oh my gosh, trouble. Trevor. Coming in with the dredge line. Actually doesn't hit it, but doesn't matter. Ignite on top of him. Just first blood to Bradley early on. Messages just getting a little bit caught out as CCG find a nice collapse.
And you got to be careful about walking into some of those brushes, especially against the Nautilus. And that's really nice for Bradley, who will have a really nice first base now. Grapes. And that's something where Azir, Bradley, like you called out, he was second in MVP voting for you in Tier 3. Bradley, for me, again, I feel like he's been the best player in the tournament so far. Him getting first blood on Azir, a pick that I remember him playing back with Wildcard. His Azir was pretty damn nasty back then. It's going to be a tough one already for Lit. And that mid priority, especially when you have Xin Zhao, something that does want to invade, can be very big moving forward in these.
Yeah, Bradley also had a great series on Gatorade Gambling Azir earlier on in this tournament.
Yeah,
so
he did.
Very much a very solid pick. He actually didn't get to play a lot of it because it was banned for a majority of Qualifier 2, which is what he was playing in. Thank goodness for patch 14.6, I guess. Another CCG trade going well down in the bottom lane. Flux has to flash after Instinct and Trevor hit level 2 first.
Xin Zhao going to go for some new tech. Yukino, we're seeing this 3-wave base, and then you get Longsword with red buff. This is another angle where you can try and fight with red buff early. Meanwhile, Pisno actually adjusting his path to protect for a potential bot dive in case him made it go down. Oh, never mind.
Oh, maybe we don't even need a dive. In comes Plux as well. Trevor Great. Just one auto from Death Rock. We're going to pick it up, but Instinct will match it right back. Now the AD carries are dueling, but Kizna was here first because he did not go back to base. Instinct hitting level 3. Looking for the zap on to Kizna, but not going to be able to find it. Dragback does not find the root, and Instinct going to flash forward. The minions are going to block, but not enough as both AD carries fall. 5 kills in the first 3 minutes of this game.
I actually appreciate the play for Rockboom. I think if he hides behind the minion, it's a little bit better, but Plux goes in. The Aftershock timers are a little desynced, so Plux gets his, and it's a really good chain. It prevents Trevor from getting his Aftershock off, and he couldn't answer the W because the minions were in the way. So that's a nice angle from Lit. Then we have a little bit of a duel here from Instinct and Rockboom as Instinct tries to force Kizno off. He knows he's low, and that flash, if Rockboom stays behind the creeps...
Oh, he's trying to get under the turret.
Yeah, no, Rockboom, he's got to stay behind the creeps there. If he stays behind the creeps, that Q can't go through. He could have lived that. A little bit of a misplay there from Rockboom off of a good idea. His Instinct tried to get the 1-for-1 before he died. Rockboom kind of gets that one over to him. Rockboom's going to want that one back a little bit, but still fireworks in the bot lane early. And honestly, we just might have fireworks all series, Grapes. I feel like I'm casting OQs again. And I got to say, I couldn't be happier.
Welcome back. Yeah, this is what it's all about here in the promotion tournament, man. And in a game that was all about the bot lanes in game number one, it's going to be the same thing here in game number two, it seems.
I got a taste of it, you know, when it came to the Ole Miss series that we had yesterday, Grapes. Yeah. I got a taste of OQs, and now I'm just going to get a full best of five of 1 kill a minute minimum. That's what we're here for.
Oh, yeah. And actually, the only best of five that was live casted in the OQs was a 3-0 from CCG against Ole Miss. So we're in uncharted territory right now, man. This might be the first time we go more than three. Rockboom gonna get hooked up by Trevor again as Plux uses the W to escape. Yukino in the area this time around, so that means that Lit's bottom lane cannot go in safely. Back into the bush he goes. Audacious charge onto Rockboom as he tries to get that ward off, and they're gonna have enough to at least stop him, but in comes Instinct jumping over the wall, and they'll take down Plux. It's now 4-2 in favor of Lit. Yukino finding a nice return on the initial gank.
You can see Kizno, he was just completing his clear. He's like, I got a phage, and bot lane's just doomed. As that wave is frozen on Rock Boom, so these deaths for Plux, no jungle being bought. Really good call by Yukino, just spending so much time here. Rock Boom's trying to get up just to change the wave, and he can't.
Oh, down the top lane as
he's
well.
He's dead.
Ragoon got pretty low. Yeah, in came Trevor. Rock Boom tried to crash the wave, but did not get close enough, no. And so he's going to take that extra death on top of all these minions being denied.
And this is one where, you know, for Kizno, it's kind of hard not to help your lane out here. Is Crimson.
Dragoon. Backs back in, hits a death drop. Sudden, that's the kill. A solo kill for Dragoon. Crimson just, I guess, didn't know the angle right there.
This series is everywhere. I mean, I don't think there's a reason for Crimson to go down. He thought he could get the kill, but not the case. Meanwhile, we have a level 2 Rell helping out Kizno with the dragon. We are 6 minutes in. That Rell is rather sad this game, but I think bot lane's really doomed, and if we thought Instinct had a lead in the last game, well, he's 4-1 now, Grapes, and I don't know how Lit gets to play this one out, especially if Zeri gets this far ahead, as we're going to get a couple replays. This is the first trade from Crimson, as he gets a really nice combo off, sidesteps that. So yeah, Dragoon, he's nice and low, but notice how Dragoon didn't pop his W, does use it for the heal. Of course, when you have that empowered W on the Rakdos, you do get the shield break. This wave... It's kind
of expecting level 6, I guess.
Oh, the bone plating came back. I think bone plating came back, and that kind of threw him off. And then level 6 comes in. Oh, unlucky for Crimson. If bone plating is out there, he does get that kill, but bone plating was back. Dragoon survives, and that's much needed for Lit.
Yeah, after the bot lane, it's kind of gotten a little out of hand at this point. I mean, despite Rock Boom having those two kills, he's now down a ton of farm, a full level at this point as well.
Yeah, let's,
so
let's see.
Dragoon getting that solo kill is good.
How ugly are these bot lane items going to look? Because that's my real concern right now. Yeah, that's not great.
Yeah,
that's Zerker Greaves. We're up pretty big here for Rock Boom. And with Trevor, the Nautilus having Ignite up, you're just going to be able to continuously push forward. Each of them have a level up on their opponents. Just trying to pay a little bit of respect right now because Yukino's not on the bot side of the map. He did take the first two grubs, but now off this reset, Yukino, he's going to be back bot. And you're going to see Instinct and Trevor push really hard to try and make this advantage even bigger.
Yeah, Instinct level 6, Rockman level 4. It gets ugly, especially if Instinct and Trevor are able to hold the wave in a certain position where Lit are unsafe. And Yukino now hitting level 6. I think this is a very, very easy gank angle, despite Rockman having a splash coming up in a couple of seconds.
You gotta believe that Trevor has his time. They're gonna look, and they're doing everything they can to freeze this wave.
This really sucks.
Continue to get more and more Stark. Kizno's on the top side of the map. I think Kizno's got to start switching his pathing to actually start coming bot, because you can see how doomed Rock Boom is. I mean, this game is... You don't have mid move, this game's over. There is nothing to do to help this bot lane. And we did see a couple situations where I remember Lit being rather starved out. There was one game where I think Rock
Boom... Oh, I remember what you're talking about, yeah.
Yeah, they won that game. That was the best. Or I don't know if it was the best or the worst. Long story short, he had 2 CS at 5 minutes.
Yeah. Shout out Aaron on the Kalista. He was dirty there in the laning phase. Unfortunately, weren't able to close that game out. But looks like Kizno finally making his way back as Rock Boom dinks level 5. Potentially there for a counter engage. As we can go a little bit more aggressive this time around. Nice flash from messages. Getting away from the shuffle as Yukino was in the area.
No dragon yet, but there is a blue buff, and Trevor's trying to push forward as... Aftershock out from Fox.
Yukino going a little bit far, trying to steal the blue buff, and now going to get just jumped on with a Cyclone. Unraveled Earth comes out. That's messages picking up the kill. And now they stun up Bradley as well. It is now a 3v3. Trevor looking pretty good, but Instinct going crazy here with the Lightning Crash, looking for another kill on the Rock Boom. He has to flash on out. CCG taking over after that initial kill. It's a double kill for Bradley, and Rock Boom not looking long for this world.
Oh, that is, how many kills on Instinct now? Is that 6? He's trying to get more than a kill of it himself.
I will say, Instinct had 6 kills at this point of the game last time, so it's not over just yet for Lit, but the situation just looks a little different. I thought Yukino overextended here.
Oh, he did for sure, but when your bot lane's this far ahead, there is really no overextension. There's just baiting for a fight, Grapes, as all the cooldowns go into the Xin Zhao, and everything's looking nice for Lit. They're like, oh boy, we might be able to get ourselves a shutdown, but Bradley shifts the sands to make sure the fight is a front-to-back for Instinct coming in. A lot of cooldowns being burned. Instinct with a huge advantage in levels and items. Able to make a big difference in this one. Because my attention is actually drawn to the pip, as we're going to see Rock Boom and the replay get chased down. But Crimson under a little bit of pressure on the top side.
Yeah, already hopped that death realm. Here comes messages as well. Crimson tries to flash forward to wait for Yukino, but Dragoon just obliterates him with his Q. That bonus damage on an isolated target, enough to pick up his second solo kill as Yukino cannot do anything to help.
I gotta say, I know Crimson was, like, you know, rightfully very hyped from OQs, but I do want to sing some of the praises of Dragoon, as I don't want to talk about the static shivs area that I already see 10 minutes in. That's disgusting. hold on. Okay, we might actually have to talk about Bot. Yeah. Rockboom's dead.
Rockboom still does not have that Featherstorm, and so he is still a very, very easy target. He's now three levels behind Instinct, as he's going to pick up kill number six for real this time.
Yeah, that's a tough one. I know Rockboom had a massive last game. This game, though, got off to a rough start, and it is only getting rougher. But I'm going to ignore that and choose to talk about Dragoon glow-up that we've seen.
Let's do
Dragoon
it. Yeah.
Was someone for me that he finally made it in the Challengers League, and it was too late. Because first off, he promoted with Supernova, and then they didn't keep any of the roster, and that was crap. And then the rules got changed. So regardless, he ended up over at Lit, and I can't talk in this series. We have more fights.
Yep,
you know.
Bro. They get taken down a little bit. Message is going to die. Bradley with a nice shuffle to lock Kizno down, but Dragoon is pretty big. He's trying to fight this in a 1v2 against both the soul laners of CCG. Obliterate doing a lot of damage. Already potentially going to try to make a trade, but Bradley now upable on the Azir. That's his fifth kill.
In Instinct 1v2, they might try. Rockboom doesn't have six yet. He's down three levels. When have you seen a marksman down three levels? Oh, Instincts!
He's going forward! He's jumping in 1v2. Both of his opposing bot laners don't have ult. It is just too easy. He gets rooted under the tower, though, but it will be a double kill going over. Instinct just going absolutely berserk.
He's up for the most FF. Get us out of the game. Go next, please. Oh, my God. CCG, they want revenge. Oh, boy. This is a roughie. It's honestly so rough, you can kind of laugh it off. Let's talk about the top lane fight first. There's a flick from Yukino. He gets stunned up. They're trying to get whatever they can here on the side of Wit. Bradley, the shove doesn't connect. It's a nice W. Kizno's doing all he can to buy time, and Dragoon's in here. He just doesn't have R, and Dragoon's really fed. He's doing all the damage he can to the Crimson, but Bradley, untouched, able to get through this one. And then we have the 1v2 bot, as Instinct looks at the level, says, I think I can do this. And he does! As, you wanna take this replay, Grapes?
Well, I know Yukino is known for his famous Yukino slide, but this is the Instinct slide. Jumping over the wall, popping his area ulti, flashing in to take down Flux, and then now Rockboom also. I mean, there's not much to cat to like analyze over
honestly,
this. It's just him being very fed.
Honestly, I will say, good attempt on the root from Rockboom. He almost turned that one, but that's not the case. And now I see a Phantom Dancer in the Zarya's kit at 12:39.
Yeah, they're going to look for a pick, though, try to get themselves back into this game. They're going to try to start it on to Trevor, but he buys enough time for the rest of the carries to arrive. Wind becomes lightning, and Kizna becomes dead. Plux going to fall as well, 2-for-1 in favor of CCG.
Yeah, remember with the Tom and Jerry memes? I feel like Jerry's doing really good without Tom here. It's just all Jerry. Jerry's running the Rift as Instincts. He has a Phantom Dancer in his inventory. He had it at 12:30. Look at those items.
TP. It's two items to not even one.
You're level
on
nine.
Side.
That's your inventory. He's smurfing. We're going in.
He's gonna jump in. 1v3.
Oh, no.
Okay, we surely cannot get out of this one. Instinct. All right, we're limit testing a little bit. It's game two. We
cannot
okay.
be serious with that. All right, that's fine. It got punished. It's fine. Where'd the shutdown go?
It went over to Kizno, actually, so 1k for him.
Okay, you know what? Wukong, it went Trinity Force. You could be kind of big on Wukong later on. That's the cope. The top side. You're doing Kizno. You gotta lift some weights on this one, buddy.
We'll see. I mean, they've come back from unfathomable circumstances on Supernova and on Lit.
That's the best part.
It's definitely possible.
The best part about this game is that Lit, their bot lane, has legitimately come back from worse than this.
A lot of it was actually off the back of messages specifically. Unfortunately, this time he's not on that smolder. He's on Talia, which is a little bit less scaling.
Oh, okay. You know what? Oh. It's a smolder game. It doesn't count. They have not come back from worse than this. All right.
Another Rift Herald here for CCG. Yukina's going to pick that one up. 6,500 gold at 14 minutes. Going to be a little bit more as the second tower will go down in mid lane. Yukina going to drop that Herald. Dragoon has the Death Realm and Flash, and he's going to try to maybe survive a dive here 1v4.
Well, he's got Death Realm, so he could make this a 1v1. Let's see who Dragoon chooses to be honorable.
Nobody just yet. There he picks Yukino. Two level lead, and Yukino gonna be in a little bit of trouble. Pops the crescent guard to bump him away, and potentially buys enough time to make sure Dragoon not able to get that kill. It was a valiant effort from Dragoon, but he will be smashed by the head of Crimson, who picks up kill number two for himself.
Yes, the Death Realm into Crescent Guard, as the duel was honorable, but Zinzo pushed him away.
I'm deciding to have fun with this game.
No, the whole point of the Crescent Guard is to pick a worthy opponent in the 1v1, and
it
Dragoon...
Is.
Exactly. And Yukino was not honoring that. That was
no,
cool.
Yeah. I mean, I feel like that could have been a Game of Thrones duel right there.
Yeah, another arrow gonna get taken down here. I wish I could follow up. I unfortunately have not watched the entirety.
That's fine.
Of that show. So.
You know what? Great show, Grapes. I feel like if you watch episode one, you'll be hooked from there. That's
I've heard
all,
good so. Things. Yeah.
Yeah. It's just don't watch the last three seasons. It's fine.
I've also heard that. Yeah.
Yeah. Crimson trying to make something happen. You know, didn't have Crescent Guard up yet. Now Instinct.
All right. Let's see if that 1K gold shutdown does anything. Instinct going in. Rock Big. Boom going to pick up another kill. It will be Kizno collecting the shutdown as Instinct goes down again. Now in the bottom side of the jungle, there is a bit of a 2v2 skirmish breaking out. Yukino trying to take down this blue buff as Gon smited it away. And it will be that objective secured. And Instinct is still limit testing a little bit here.
Yeah, well done from Lit on baiting Instinct into a false sense of security for the second time in a row. Kizno jumping over the wall and finding spin to win there. That's big. And I will say, in all seriousness, you know, one of the reasons I was worried about this Zeri is because Zeri... you know, is somewhat range gated. You do have to go in. And Taliyah, Wukong, Rell, that's A, something really nice to combo Zeri, but also Xayah with the feathers can actually buy space. So in all seriousness, Instinct will have to be a little bit careful about how he chooses fights. And we have seen a couple mishaps from him, but he's still so damn fed that this game would have been FF if it was a scrim. I feel very confident saying that. So we'll just make sure that CCG is able to play this round correctly as Flux might get jumped on from Yukino. Messages is behind. They don't see this.
Maybe CCG get baited once again. It was around this position in game number one, Covey, where things started to turn. But, okay, no, it looks like this time they learn from their mistakes. They're going to back away. I was going to say at the top of this game, after draft, all five of CCG's members will get affected by Taliyah's Unraveled Earth. So, in an even team fight, like, things could actually end up getting a little bit, you know, advantage towards Lit. But we have a long ways to go before we reach that point.
Dragon being taken by CCG on time. Well done from them. I'm gonna be honest, I don't even know how Lit got a dragon in this game. I just kind of assumed that the first two dragons went over to that 9-1 Zeri that we had at one point. That said, dragon being taken might be a dive here on the Crimson. He's gonna try and thin the wave.
Yep, pushes Dragoon back, pushes the half HP. Here comes Messages and Kizno. Dominus getting popped. Crimson trying to at least clear the wave before he starts the fight, but it will not happen. Another shutdown going over. Messages get executed. I guess that's all right. But
he didn't sneak out of tower range. Unfortunately, took a bonus shot. He goes down, and now Trevor.
Here's a trade on the other side, though. Yep. Rockboom popping the Featherstorm. Actually, Trevor getting very low. Plux surviving and getting that kill onto the Nautilus. Plux now has to flash away. Instinct getting a little bit unlocked here with that lightning crash, but Lit actually get away with another kill. 2-for-1, and that tower going over to CCG.
It's not even a 2-for-1. Messages went down to the turret. It was an honorable death. As
oh, true.
Now the turret goes over to Lit. They're actually cutting into the gold beam.
Yeah, they're getting back in this. Okay. Like, the objective bounties are here. Like, this is the point when you're playing Clash. You're down a lot, and then your boys are like, all right, guys, we got objective bounties at least. We could, like, start to take some. And hey, Kizno has three shutdowns. Dragoon got that top lane turret. Like, top side for Lit's pretty strong.
That's true, because if you FF Clash, that's truly bad mental. So I appreciate Lit staying strong in this one. And to be fair to Lit, I know I've had a couple laughs with how fed Zeri got. We are still sitting at a 19-minute three-item IE. This game is much closer than what it should be. And it's props to Lit. It's a 6k gold deficit now. It should not have gotten better for them. It did. And their comp actually does have some answers to Zeri. And as you pointed out, Taliyah, really valuable this game, regardless of the gold that Taliyah is sitting at. His message, of course, is behind just due to a lot of factors, you know, trying to save plays and Bradley also getting ahead early. Regardless, though, Mordekaiser was spotted. Trevor spots Kizno on the red buff. I think Kizno has to take that red buff. Sometimes at this point of the game, you want to save red buff until you get past that 20-minute mark so everyone gets it. But as you can see, this side of the jungle is still owned by CCG.
What? Is that a blind hook by Trevor just going on to the clone?
Yeah. You just took red buff. You can reason that someone could be there.
Pretty impressive stuff. Trevor, yeah. Finding a lot of good hooks early. Dating back to level one, even. And
and first blood.
Like pretty solid. Yeah, pretty solid.
And then the
second
That's
where things really ended here, first blood.
Yeah. I do like what Lit's doing right now. I know this game is, like, again, really doomed, but they have been trying to get Xayah some gold. The Rock Boom was actually able to farm a couple waves bottom into that Renekton, who was set behind by Dragoon, and it's actually okay at the moment. So Xayah will have to go back to pick some gold up in the mid lane. This will be pushed in, but at least Xayah is getting some CS. We'll see if they engage on to Bradley here, who is really trying to play by his team. I really like how Bradley's positioned here. Very respectful that Kisno could be in this brush.
CG looks trying to take down this tier 1. Bradley dashing in. A big Shurima shuffle finds 2, but it will be Bradley going down first. Dragoon goes down as Instinct picks up kill number 10. But that's honestly pretty good for Lit. They get another shutdown. That's 1k once again going down.
Oh no, Crimson's bot though. That's a big one.
Re-engage, depth charge, finding 3. Dashing in is Yukino. Message is picking up on the kill. CCG are just going too far forward. The trade, of course, is Crimson on the other side. Now he teleports in. Going to be very strong in a potential engage. That's a big laser coming out from Instinct, but not enough gap for Crimson to close. He will back away and Lit honestly come out all right.
He killed the minions. Crimson, he had the flashy if he actually wants that play, and I feel like Crimson might have had a triple kill lined up, but yet again, Lit survives. They get some more gold back in their pockets, and somehow this game hasn't broken yet.
I think that was Messages who picked up the 1k shutdown. If we can get...
He got 2 kills in that
team, but like, he was one who was very, very far behind at that point. Getting those shutdowns, starting to get back. He has a Cosmic Drive now. Let's see Bradley just going a little bit too far. He gets a nice shuffle, but the cost of his life.
Again, you're going into Taliyah, so the insta-flick from Messages, everything burned from Bradley to get in. He wasn't able to flash react because of the Wukong knockup. Messages gets hooked. And again, this fight, Instinct's hitting the turret. He doesn't feel like he can dash past the rocks, or Instinct just doesn't want to step up. Trevor going a little bit deep. We have the re-engage come in. Those minions went down to the W of Zeri, or else you would have seen Crimson get a double. Again, I think if Crimson flash commits there after those minions go down, it was a little bit bang bang, as they like to say in baseball. You might appreciate that one, Grapes. It's bang bang play of the base. The minions were down, couldn't get that second E to get in there. But regardless, I do want to highlight QSS for the Nautilus. That is nice. That's a really easy target for Mordekaiser to take down. So he's no longer an option to get pulled into that death realm.
Would be an easy kill for Dragoon. Some stats to steal away, automatically making it a numbers advantage off the bat. So smart for Trevor to make sure he's not a target. Baron, and just at the top of conversation, Kizno catching out Bradley yet again, who has to use the Emperor's of the Divide to get some distance. Here comes Trevor, finding the hook onto Message and Instinct dashing over the Lightning Crab. That is one kill for CCG. Instinct flashes over the wall. He's looking for Kizno as CCG have collapsed in a 4v2. Dragoon and Kizno trying to save things as Rock Boom is joining, but not there just yet. Instinct goes golden. Here comes Rock Boom and Plux. They do not find the kill, but finally Instinct will drop. Kino on the backside, looking for the Xayah, but Rock Boom has an opportunity to go in this fight. The Blade Caller finds a lot, but not a single kill. Bradley gets the quadra kill, and CCG once again regain control.
Honestly, that Zhonya's from Instinct was kind of tough. I thought for a second that Lit had a chance. We're going to get a quick replay of this one. As Bradley, he walks into Kizno Messages, but he gets out of the combo. That's one charge of Kizno's ult burned, and a great dredge line from Trevor to lock down Taliyah, and that Unraveled Earth being gone means that CCG can kind of push with no worries. Dragoon, Kizno were isolated. And Instinct, I think he went gold to dodge out on the full Flux combo, but it still comes in as Flux didn't burn the rest of it. Instinct didn't have flash. That was his only option. He still goes down. He pushed pretty far into that fight. Fortunately for him, rest of his team ahead enough. Rock Boom not doing the damage quite yet. Bradley cleans everything up as he picks up the quadra kill. And CCG, this was a game that, for me, should have been a bit cleaner. Things got a little silly in here, Grapes, for many reasons. But it is a game that CCG should win. And fortunately, both their carries were able to step up at different points of the game. Instinct getting ahead early. Okay, Trevor.
Get caught out again. It's four members of Lit trying to take down the enemy support, but they just do not touch the Nautilus at this point. Crescent Guard pushes Kizno away. We'll get shoved underneath, and Instinct goes down again to Rock Boom. Still a 5v4. Teleport coming in. Dragoon ready to join the fight, but he's caught between three members of CCG. They dash in to take down Bradley. No carries alive for CCG. Are Lit going to do this again, Cubby? Trevor has to use the QSS to try to escape, and it's just a 2-for-1 with Lit coming out on top.
I mean, there are so many tools to answer Zeri. Instinct got stunned up trying to dash through Unraveled Earth, never had the ult going, and Instinct got one shot. Bradley did his best in the back half, but he was able to be focused down. And again, I don't think this game should be in this state at all, but it continue to find
engage. There's the engage.
Rock Boom
has totally untouched in this fight. Gets one into Trevor. Finally gets jumped up with a blade. Featherstorm is beautiful. Gets himself a double kill. And now it is jungler versus top laner with a support to boot for Lit. Crimson has to run away in the 2v1, but now he dashes forward with a slice and dice. Eclipse already procced. Dragoon looking as well. They have their eyes set on Dragon. They want to stop Soul Point.
How is this game close?
That's the Lit magic.
The Lit magic has gone too far. I feel like I'm watching Cincy Fear from last spring. Instinct has Zhonya's in this game. Again, it's tough. Instinct has a lot of stuff to worry about. And we're going to see yet again in this fight. Instinct, he gets caught. Trevor gets caught. They try and flick Bradley. I appreciate them ignoring the tank, going for the high value target, but does get a really good engage off for Trevor. But look at Instinct.
Rocks are down. He gets flicked
by messages. Doesn't see it. He's kind of hit in the wall. That's a one shot with a Wukong follow up. And then Bradley's stuck. He was trying to really help Instinct in that moment. He did his best in the 1v4, but he's isolated. This Dragoon keeps everyone busy on the back half. And CCG, I mean, honestly, at this point, Grapes, they got to clean things up if they want to win this best of five. Yeah. Like, this kind of gameplay, this lead is so big. I feel like it's unthrowable, but CCG is doing everything in their power to try and make this game interesting. Just not what you want to do if you're CCG.
And just imagine if Rockboom was just a little bit more fed. I mean, that would have been a 1v3. He'd have like 10 kills at this point instead of 6. CCG, though, they do have this Baron for about 5 seconds longer. They have one more wave to try to push down this top lane inhibitor turret. The laser finds one, but they will not have any more Baroned up minions, so they do not break open an inhibitor. That's pretty big, especially with, you know, Lit evening up the dragon score. Rockboom now has 3 items, and now Messages does as well. This is all of a sudden a very losable game for CCG if things get out of hand.
Yeah, I think CCG, I don't know, maybe if game one wasn't enough of an ego check, maybe this was. I don't know. I think they're still going to win game two, but there have been a lot of plays taken that, again, I just feel like they can't take, and this is the best 5 to get in the NACL. I mean, this means a lot to these guys. I know they're taking it serious, but there are just some things happening in this one where it's tough. Like, I know it's a tough comp for Zarya Azir to operate. You can really see the value of Taliyah in this draft. I appreciate what Lit's doing, but CCG, they gotta take a deep breath and make sure they clean this one up, because there are some elements for Lit that are decent in the back half of the game. Like, Zaya's now with 3 items. That's a Zhonya's 4th for Zeri. That doesn't help a ton with the damage. No, Zeri gets a little bit of benefit from her ultimate, but Zaya's pretty much on par at this point, Graves. Like, this game's not completely out of reach for Lit.
I will say, like, CCG, they faced situations like this, like, in qualifiers where they were either down early and, like, were able to come back, or they, like, you know, fooled around a little bit in the late mid-game stages and ended up winning the game anyway. But you have to remember, this is the promotion tournament. Like, this is a team from the NACL. They promoted here just a split ago. And maybe the competition is just a little bit tighter this time around. You know, in Crimson, they got spotted on that ward. Lit know exactly where they are, and they're going to push them away. Flux not going for the engage, although he did have the Flash Magnet Storm if he wanted to pull.
Yeah, they got to respect the wave states. And I Lit have stabilized at this point. I know that gold lead is what it is. It's really on Bradley at this point. His Instinct does have some of that gold into Bazanya's. It will be something that he can use to keep himself safe. But if I'm Lit, I'm looking at the Azir. If I can get him down before that Emperor's Divide comes in, I think that's the big advantage that Lit could be looking for. But you got to believe the rest of the comp we've seen can kind of manage Zeri.
Yeah. We'll see how CCG set up for this Baron. It's coming up in 50 seconds. That could be a big tool. Dragoon might have gotten himself caught. Pops the Death Realm onto Yukino once again. He should be able to win this duel. Just depends on how quickly he can kill the Xin Zhao. He will pop out. The rest of Lit are here to collapse. Yukino going to be able to use an Ice Audacious Charge on a Plux. He'll come in with a Magnet Storm. Lit are a little bit far behind, but they do find the kill onto Yukino. Nice command stun out of Plux. And now the fight has begun. Instinct pops the Lightning Crash. He'll pick up the first kill. Jumps over the wall. Has to go golden. Rockboom using the ultimate of his own. Crimson in the middle of a 1v3. Not going to find a kill. There's Bradley. Ooh. But there's Rockboom. Finds himself a double kill on the Blade Caller. And Lit still coming out ahead.
Lit find a split in the fight. And again, that front to back, their ability to hold the line behind these Unraveled Earths. I know that I talked about the importance of taking down Azir, that given that he doesn't have defensive tools like Azania's, but I think at this point, you really got to focus on taking down Taliyah if you are CCG, because every Unraveled Earth that comes out feels like it just stymies everything that CCG wants to do. As you called out earlier, Grapes, It's effective against every member of CCG's comp. And the one fight we saw really go their way was when Taliyah was immediately removed.
Yeah. And, I mean, Rock Boom, this is the same story that we saw against Wildcard, right, Covey? I mean, he was down so much at the start of the game.
Dude,
he's now fully back
mental.
In with four items. That's a Lord Doms and a Phantom Dancer. This guy will do a ton of damage on this pick.
Ironclad mental Rock Boom. Oh,
got
man.
Rock solid mental.
I will say, it is an LDR for each of our marksmen that just all of a sudden spawned. So, Rock Boom and Instinct, able to pick these up. Even more damage coming in. I know Instinct with the Zhonya's, but we did see the pop on that R, as you do have a pretty nice AP ratio, and Instinct can make people go pop off that ultimate, so. But, I mean, he's even levels. It was a four-level difference for Instinct at one point in this game, and it's even for Rock Boom. This game's actually competitive.
He's going to solo the dragon.
It's a solo Drake for a Baron. I will say Rock Boom, he's going to be late to this fight. Could be really dangerous for Lit. This isn't burned soon enough. Might have to give.
Here's a teleport. Crimson going to come in. Here comes Dragoon. He takes Yukino out of the fight. And Kizno steals the Baron. It's Lit coming out on top of the objective. But will they win the fight? They already lose their jungler. Dragoon stuck in the death realm. Yukino not going to die. So two from Lit will fall. Instinct still has the ult proc. Picks up a third. Rock Boom now has to run. And all of a sudden things get dangerous for Lit if they cannot escape. But there's the Featherstorm. Instinct. This is his moment. He dashes over the wall. He gets another. He goes golden, and only Messages is able to survive. We thought it was a miracle for Lit with Kizno stealing the Baron, but Instinct takes over the fight, and CCG will even this series up.
This game is going to give me a heart attack, man. I can't believe that Lit actually got the Dragon of Baron off that, but no fight. Instinct plays a clean one. Messages is up, but he is the only member up as he was taken out first, and this is going to be it for CCG. It was a massive lead for them early, and Lit... they broke the lead in game one.
Hold on.
Too big for them to break in game two, right. And this will be CCG's game.
Nice shuffle from Bradley, showing off the hands a little bit as this game took 32 minutes. We thought it was going to end about 10 minutes earlier, but CCG win all the same.
I'm never saying FF a game ever again in OQs. It's never happening. We got to replay this last one as we're going to take a look at exactly what happened. But oh my goodness, what a ballistic game. Zeri having 9 kills and 2 items at 12:30, and then you're able to actually make it like this close. Lit can honestly take a huge win off that. This early game was so dumb that they really can feel like they can win this series as Kizno did sneak in, finds the steal. I want to see how Messages goes down, as he was the first one to go down, or I should say respawn. He didn't go down. He was just kind of chased out. Yeah. Man,
it's
really
Instinct.
Tough.
There he is.
Yeah. all right, there's Instinct. He's able to... there's no Unraveled Earth ahead of him. I think if Rock Boom and Messages retreated together, there were some odds that they could actually make something happen, but this wasn't the case. And Messages being forced out. Instinct able to turn that lead he had into the win. There were some slip-ups. There were a couple moments where I was questioning what CCG was doing. It was going through their heads, but they managed to pull things together and make this a 1-1, and... we have a crazy series going on right now, Grapes. That game was wild. That was one of the craziest games I've ever casted for so many different reasons. That was a really silly one.
If Lit ended up coming back, it would have been
the
best game
mind.
Of all time. But
I would have said 3-0 Lit. Talk about plot armor for Lit if they win that game, you know?
I mean, they've Dragoon and Kizno specifically, been in this promotion tournament 2 times already. They've won both. And so they do not know what it's like to end up losing this promotion tournament. And so far, they have the plot armor a little bit. Did not stand as hard as CCG still took game one. They've evened things up, and it's a best of 3 from this point forward. We'll be right back after this short break with game number 3.
Introducing the new footlong sidekicks at Subway. Try the warm and delicious footlong cookie, footlong pretzel, or footlong churro.
My name is Bilal, aka Meister Crimson, and I play top lane for CCG. I didn't grow up with too many video games. It was mainly just Call of Duty with my twin brother, Sniper. For League, I started in Season 8, I believe. It started with, obviously, my older brother, Viper. And then me and Sniper found the game, and we decided to play one person with the keyboard and one person with the mouse, because we were pretty clueless at the time. I was more of the mouse, and Sniper was more of the keyboard. Again, maybe Master Yi, stuff like that, you know? I saw my twin brother hit Challenger, and then, like, I saw all the hype around him, and I'm like, I see him, like, as myself. And I felt like I could do just as good as he did, you know? I played like 2,000 games. I hit it like 2 seasons after I started taking ranked seriously. I just wanted to be like a 2-trick at first. Afterwards, I didn't even know I really wanted to go pro. I just like thought like Challenger was enough for me, but I saw my twin brother hit rank one, and I'm like, hold up, I can do this too, you know? The first ever team I played on was Dig or Radiance, and it was in 2022. As soon as I hit, like, I think you have to be 15, I'm like, my brother's already on 100 teams. I'm pretty sure he's on the amateur team. I'm like, okay, it's my time to compete as well, you know? It was really fun, like, the first year I played, but, like, I was really clueless, you know? Like, I had no experience. I didn't really know, like, who was good, who was bad, you know? I didn't expect too much going into the team. Like, I just wanted to, like compete and see how I felt first, you know? Like, I heard good things about them, and I realized, like, sure, like, might as well go for it, you know? Going from mid to top was something I'll never regret down the line, because, like, I really thought mid was my role, but realizing that I wanted to go pro and realizing that I actually have to start, like, playing mages and playing, like, things outside of my comfort zone, I realized, like mages really which wasn't something I personally enjoyed. Committing competitive, like, a lot of it was just mainly farming, and it was, like, you can get, like, those lucky, like, solo kills or, like, really well-played solo kills, but I feel like top lane is a lot more volatile than mid lane. I always knew, like, deep down inside of me that, like, I preferred to, like brawl it out 1v1 on an island, you know? I wasn't too, like, focused on playing on a team last year. I really wanted rank 1 last year. The main goal was to hit rank 1 and prove myself that way. Like, hitting rank 1, like, was a really hype moment. But what it made me realize is that if you want to climb in solo queue, like, you really need to stick to a certain few champions and, like learn what, like, your win con is. I believe it was sometime last year, like, during August or September, both my brothers were talking about going to Korea together, and then I overheard them, and I'm like this is a good chance for me to go as well, you know? I heard, like, a bunch of players improved from going to Korea, and, like, it was, like, a really fun opportunity. I just spammed games every day. Like, I hit, like, Challenger 700 LP. All three of us were sitting beside each other. Honestly, it's really fun, but also, like, there was a lot of frustrating moments in solo queue. Like me and Sniper were brawling it out together. We'd even get into fights every now and then, but for the most part, I think I enjoyed Korea. I don't know if you know this, but all four of my teammates, they've all played in Academy before. I feel like they had, like, good experience that I can learn from, and hopefully, like, we can maybe even make an ACL. In terms of comp experience, they definitely helped me a lot, because I think I still have a lot to improve on. I think in terms of laning phase, like, Bradley can help me with that too, you know? I would say, like, my team is good, like, pretty much all around, and they can help me with whatever I struggle with. I definitely want to be on, like, the big stage one day and face, like, my twin brother. I think that'd be, like, such a hype match to watch. And my family wouldn't know which side to root for, you know? From what my brother told me on how his scrims are going, I think definitely I have a chance. I think a big goal of mine for this year at the very least is to play on an NACL team. I think with CCG, I think we can definitely have a chance to make it. And if that's the team that ends up working out for me, then I'll go for it, you know? You can go catch me at twitch.tv/mysword crimson. And that's where I stream and show all my games that I grind to rank 1 for. Thank you.